Hi. As I promised you in our last show, we're here today in Bordeaux. Now, Bordeaux brings to mind the richest wine-growing country in the world. But in my travels around the city, I found that Bordeaux is rich in a lot more than just the wine. The people have a certain color, all their own, and the country itself is rich in history. To help explain a little bit about the history, we have today with us Monsieur Le Laurent. Now, Monsieur Le Laurent has worked as a wine taster for over 35 years, and he's also helped produce Bordeaux wines all over France. He knows a great deal about the city, too. Monsieur Laurent, can you tell us what made Bordeaux a famous wine capital way back in the 3rd century AD?
Yes, Bordeaux is well known for its wines, as you told, but cannot put all Bordeaux in a glass. You must speak of a very old history from the Romans and the medieval times and the 18th century and so on.
If we were to go back a little bit in history, say back to the 12th century, didn't England and the United Kingdom play a important part politically in the founding of Bordeaux?
Yes, Bordeaux belonged during 3 centuries, from the 12th to the 15th century, to the crown of England, because our princess of Aquitania married an English king. But at that time, the English king didn't speak English. He spoke Gascon, our language here. And at that time, also, Bordeaux was wealthy because of the trade. They shipped all the wines to London. It was easier to ship a cask of Bordeaux to London than to send it to Paris. And their customers were all English people. They drank claret.
So you could actually say that it was the French that introduced wine into England?
Yes, yes.
What about the English? We know them as tea drinkers. How could they start drinking wine all of a sudden?
They didn't drink tea at that time because they hadn't yet conquered India. And they drank only ale and claret. And the king of England bought sometimes so much claret that he couldn't pay for it, and the borderless people had more liberties, more privileges. Yes, and at that time the English people were as we are now. We drink only tea when we are very sick.
If you can, look down the pathway here and see the famous building in back of me. It's called the Opéra. It's the large opera and theater house in Bordeaux. Mr. Le Laurent has explained to me that this building was built before the famous Opéra in Paris. Can you tell me the year that this building was erected?
Exactly 1780.
You see, that was before, and I think some of the designing that was done in this house was also used later in Paris, correct?
Yes, namely the staircase, a wrought iron staircase.
He explained also to me that there are many shops on the inside where the rich patrons of the theater would come to shop and eat and then spend the whole day there.
Oh yes, you could spend the whole day, and still there is a restaurant inside.
Now this building, across the street, there is another large building, very famous building from Bordeaux. What is that?
That is the Grand Hotel, one of the finest hotels of Bordeaux, and which was in the old times, at the time of the beginning of the theater, a mansion of a rich Bordelais.
So people actually lived in it, but now it has been turned into a hotel.
Yes, it's a hotel, a very fine hotel.
We have left the city of Bordeaux itself and moved out into the rich wine-growing region. We're here, as you can see, in the background, in a beautiful city named Saint-Emilion. Mr. Le Laurent, what makes Saint-Emilion so famous?
It is famous for its wines and also for its landscape and for the old buildings you see everywhere.
He has explained to me that these buildings were built during the medieval period. Now, they are still the ruins standing today that we see, correct?
That's quite right, yes.
You explained that the city is built on a rock quarry, and so the limestone from underneath the city was used to build...
It was built to use the town itself, Libourne, and even a part of Bordeaux.
Can you tell me who grew the wines?
Everybody. Everybody.
And so we have small wine-growing farms in the city, and then the larger vineyards out...
Yes, but even the larger vineyards are not very big here. It's about 5-6 hectares.
The region looks hilly and rocky. Is that good for grapes?
That's the very best soil for grapes. A poor soil and a fine wine, it's good, very good.
Come with me now down into a typical wine cellar. This one here is one of the largest in the world. The grapes are brought in upstairs from all over the region and put into large casks where they're allowed to ferment for up to about 3 weeks. After that, the grape skins and the seeds settle to the bottom. This is called clarification because the top wine clarifies. Then the fermented wine has to age in another cask for sometimes up to 18 months. And after that, you can see that the bottles are lying on their sides. This is so that the wine inside can flow into the cork and keep the cork very moist, because if the cork is allowed to dry, air can pass through the cork and it ruins the wine. Come on with me and I'll show you some older wines. Let me tell you something about wine that ages. We all know that the older a wine, the better it tastes, but it's a fallacy that old wine tastes good, because wine is a living substance. It grows in the bottle and it matures, but it reaches a peak and it plateaus at that point, and after that it declines. The Sant'Emilion wines reach their peak at about 10 to 15 years. Of course, some of the finer Sant'Emilions are going to peak at about 25 years. What I'd like to do now is sample some of the wine. Now, I've had them open this case for me. This is the case where the 1979 bottles are. Here's a good one, Chateau Berliquet. Now, Chateau Berliquet is one of Sant'Emilion's finest wines. This winery produces over 45,000 bottles a year. Another important one to remember is Chateau de Bosque. This winery produces 60,000 bottles a year of that fine wine. Let's taste the Berliquet now. Now, you all know that there is an art to sampling a fine wine, and the French have developed this to the T. I'm going to see if I can do it now. First, you look through the glass of wine to see the color, and this one is nice and red, and then sniff. Mmm, it's a nice aroma. What you do then is roll the glass slowly to let the air on the top mix with the wine that's inside, and this helps the aroma, and it's going to help the flavor too. And then sip. Well, that's good. This part you've probably seen too. The French roll the wine around on their tongues, and this is letting the wine distribute across the taste buds so you can really taste the flavor. Mmm, it's round and velvety. It's a good wine. I choose this to have with our dinner, so stay with us. We're at the seashore now on the coast of the Atlantic Ocean. We're in a region called Côte Basque, which is as far south as you can go in France without bumping into the Spanish border. Today we're going to visit beautiful villages up and down the coastline that come alive in the summer with tourists. Today we're in Biarritz, a city that's famous for its casinos and nightlife and grand hotels. In 1843, Victor Hugo, when he visited the city and the region, wrote, "Biarritz is an adorable place, but my only fear is that it will become too fashionable." Well, fashionable it has become. It is known all over the world for its sandy beaches and golfing and beautiful resorts. As I promised you, we've moved up the shoreline to the first little village, which is a quaint little fishing village called Cap Breton. There's an interesting story that the local people love to tell. They explain that in the 19th century, Napoleon came here for a hunting trip with some of his comrades. He met and fell in love with a very beautiful woman, and he wanted to take her as his mistress. She agreed to be his mistress on the conditions that if and when he became emperor, he would give money to her village so that they could fortify their harbor and increase it for commercial trade. Come with us now up to our next little village on the coast, Hossegor. Hossegor has a very temperate climate, which makes it perfect for outdoor sports. And one of the favorite here is golf. Another game that originated in this Basque region of France is called Cesta Punta, or we know it as highlight in the United States. Now this fast-paced sport has become so popular that it is now played all over the world. Dance performed traditionally in the south of France. Come with me now to Sarlat. We have walked back into a culture that most people only experience from reading history books, and we're here today in a beautiful feudal castle that's nestled into the wooded area between Biarritz and Sarlat. There's a man who 30 years ago saw this castle and fell in love with it, and he devoted the rest of his life to learning its history, to educating the people around the area about its beauty. He's a poet and he's a writer, and he's explained to me a lot about this feudal castle that I'm going to try to share with you today. If you remember in your history books what happened during the medieval period, there was a lord or a baron that owned a castle like this, and the peasants lived down below. Now, in exchange for the food that the peasants would produce, the feudal lord or baron would protect them with his arms. In the 12th and 13th century, the Hundred Years' War swept this area, the war between England and France, and in this region was the heaviest hit by the war. This castle remains today as the largest and most well-preserved fortress in the entire world. There's something mystical about it as we walk through the old stone ruins. It's beautiful. We've left the city of Biarritz and the Côte de Basque region and moved across the south of France into another region, or department as the French call it, named Périgord. Now, one of the most important cities in Périgord is where we are today, a small medieval village called Sarlat. To help you understand some of the rich history of this region, I've asked a local guide to explain it. Her name is Véronique.
Is Sarlat the most populous city of the Périgord region?
Yes, the most popular, sure. Most famous because of the architecture that has been preserved and well restored, and the food industry.
The food industry, what foods are produced here that make it so famous?
Foie gras, of course, pâté de foie gras, and then fruit liqueurs, spirits.
So liqueurs, spirits and wines, and you said nuts also?
Yes, also nuts, yes.
And fabric is important also, flax and linen, some of the
yes.
Natural fibers.
Mm-hmm.
Can we go into the cemetery?
Yes, of course.
Ooh, look at this. Now, is this 9th century?
Yes, 9th century, but especially 12th century.
So it was added on to over the centuries.
Yes.
Those are tombs along the side there?
Yes, just behind you. Can you see it?
Yes, right down here.
And recesses, yes.
Oh, and look up
and
here. This is the stained glass window from the church.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but walking around the town all morning has made me really hungry, and this is my favorite part of the show. Sarlat is famous for many good restaurants, but I think I've chosen the best one that's here. I've selected the St. Albert for us to cook in today because it has a real home-cooked flavor to its food. So let's go on in now. Today we're going to prepare... I'll tell you what, let's wait till we get into the kitchen and it'll be a surprise for you. Monsieur Garrigaud, what are we going to make today?
Bonjour, aujourd'hui nous allons préparer un potage local, qui est un potage du Sarlabais, que l'on portait aux jeunes mariés La Nuit des Noces en Périgord.
This is very interesting. He says that we're going to prepare today a traditional local soup that is cooked and served before the wedding, the night before the wedding of a young man and young woman, what we would traditionally call the groom's dinner. He starts with eggs that have been separated, the egg whites and the egg yellows.
Nous utilisons de la farine.
Flour.
De l'ail.
This is garlic that has been sliced in large pieces.
Du vinaigre de vin de préférence.
Vinegar, and he prefers to use wine vinegar.
Le sel, le poivre.
Salt and pepper.
Un peu de matière grasse.
And a little bit of oil. It's also important to have bread to use with this soup, and he has chosen a sourdough bread from this region.
Je vais prendre la casserole. Je mets un tout petit peu de matière grasse.
He's putting in about 4 tablespoons of oil into a large pot that goes on the stove.
Je mets mon ail,
in
émincé.
Goes the garlic, and it looks like about 5 or 6 cloves of garlic sliced up. He has put the garlic onto the fire. The oil will heat up, and the garlic is going to get very, very lightly cooked, so it's just a soft golden color. You're not cooking it, you're just lightening the color.
Maintenant, je vais prendre un peu de farine afin d'y mettre 3 cuillerées à soupe.
He explains that now he takes the flour and puts in 3 spoonfuls of the flour into the soup that we're preparing.
Ensuite, nous allons mettre l'eau bouillie.
And then we take water. Carefully pour water into the flour mixture. He has boiling water on the stove with flour, and so he has to stir it very quickly, or that flour is going to get gummy and lumpy in the soup mixture. He takes 2 pinches of salt and a pinch of pepper.
Voilà. Et pendant que mon tourin qui prend forme va bouillir, je vais mettre mon vinaigre de vin avec mes œufs.
Once it has begun to boil again, he's going to put in the vinegar with the eggs.
Avec les œufs, le vinaigre et les œufs.
The two together.
Je vais bien le mélanger.
And with a wire whisk, he beats it. Now, these are the egg yellows. Remember, the egg whites are separate over here. It's important that he whisks it very briskly to break up the egg yellows into the wine vinegar. Now he's going to take the egg whites and put them into the soup mixture that's boiling on the stove.
Et je mélange de nouveau.
What he does now is take the mixture that he prepared earlier, the egg yellows and the wine vinegar, over to the fire. He takes a small spoonful of the soup that's been boiling on the stove and adds it into this mixture, whisks it up briskly, and then pours the egg yellow and wine vinegar mixture into the soup. And he waits for it to boil, and now our soup is ready. He takes it from the fire, and he's going to now put it into a large bowl to serve the guests.
Maintenant, je vais prendre un peu de pain de campagne dont je vous parlais tout à l'heure, que nous avons émincé.
He takes the sourdough bread that he's cut up and lines the bottom of a soup bowl with it.
Et je verse mon tourin sur le pain.
And puts the soup then on top of the bread in the bowl. Careful, it's hot. Oh, that looks good.
Et voilà, maintenant votre tourin est prêt à servir.
And now our soup is ready to serve. We're now going to prepare the main dish, and what this consists of is a roast beef served with traditional Périgord gravy sauce over it. And to complement this, he's chosen sautéed potatoes that are stirred in with herbs and bacon. Let's begin.
Nous allons prendre le roast beef. Nous allons mettre d'abord un peu de matière grasse,
okay.
Une petite louche, un peu de beurre.
So we're starting with oil and butter in the pan.
Nous allons mettre le roast beef dans la plaque ainsi préparée.
The roast beef goes into the pan.
Et nous allons saisir la viande sur le feu. Notre viande étant prête, je vais la mettre
sur le feu de façon à la saisir pour 2 ou 3 minutes.
Now the meat is ready to be put on the fire and the oil is going to let it brown slowly for about 2 to 3 minutes, just so that it's lightly browned on both sides. While the meat is browning on the stove, it's time to prepare the vegetable. Take about 8 to 10 washed potatoes and peel them and slice them. Then about 1 pound of bacon cut up fine. Use about 1 cup of minced parsley and truffles, about 1 cup. Now truffles are very expensive French mushrooms. You can use regular mushrooms if you don't have truffles. Let me tell you one thing very interesting. Truffles are grown in forests underneath the ground, and the reason they're so expensive is because it takes a special technique to get them out of the ground. Pigs and dogs that have been trained in the art of snuffing out the mushrooms go into the forest and extract them, and the farmers follow them and take the mushrooms or the truffles back into town. That's why they're so expensive.
Maintenant, je vais prendre ma poêle, mettre un peu de matière grasse.
The skillet's been warming up on the stove behind us.
2 louches de pommes de terre.
And he's put just enough oil in the pan to keep the potatoes from sticking when he puts it back on the fire.
Que je vais remettre pour les dorer.
Now they're going to brown slightly, and he put in all of the potatoes, brown slightly on the fire to make them golden.
Une fois dorés, je vais les couvrir de façon à les laisser confire.
Fine, and as soon as they have browned, you cover them with the lid and let them brown and continue sautéing or cooking for about 15 to 20 minutes.
Pendant 15 à 20 minutes, à la suite de quoi je mettrai mon jambon, mon ail et mon persil.
Fine, now at the end of 15 or 20 minutes, he's going to put in the bacon, the truffles, and the parsley that has little bits of minced garlic in it also. This is at the end, after the potatoes have finished cooking. After the potatoes have browned slightly for about 2 or 3 minutes on the fire, you remove them from the heat and add in, bit by bit, the parsley that has minced garlic added to it, the bacon that you've cut up, the truffles, and those have been sliced in fine slices or mushrooms, that is added into the potatoes. The potatoes are put back on the fire and covered, cooking for another 20 minutes. The meat has finished browning on the back burner while we've been preparing the potatoes.
Alors maintenant, je vais mettre un peu de tomate.
He's taking a tomato and cutting it in half.
De façon que le jus de tomate ne fasse pas brûler la viande.
Now when the meat cooks in the oven, the grease comes out of it and the tomatoes absorb that grease to keep it from spattering all over the oven. He's slicing an onion and placing that around to add flavor to the meat.
Et notre viande est prête à mettre au four.
Now it's ready to be put into the oven. This meat cooks at a temperature of about 350 degrees for approximately 1/2 hour. While the meat is cooking in the oven now at 350 degrees for about 1/2 hour, you prepare the Perigold gravy sauce to serve over the meat. This is made with the broth from veal, and to this, to thicken it, you add flour. So you've prepared the gravy, and then to this you add sliced truffles or mushrooms if you can't afford truffles. And also, to thicken the sauce, you can use goose liver, foie gras. Now when our meat is done, we're going to serve it to our guests. Oh, here it is, you guys, ta-da-da, look! This is the delicious roast beef and Perigold sauce that we made today. Yes, it has truffles in it. Oh, and here are the potatoes, look at that. This garlic and parsley, you're gonna love it. We got this at Saint-Emilion today. These are some of the best wines they produce.
You see?
I hope you're hungry.
It was so simple to make.
Thank you. Merci. Look at the truffles. Merci beaucoup. Fantastic. Véronique. Yes. A cute name for a cheese. Oh, good. Wait. Oh, thank you. That's perfect. Thanks. Isn't it cute? It's called Baby Brie. It's made by Alouette. Look,
cheese. Yes, ooh, isn't that cute?
It's
because it's so delicate and smooth inside. See this outer layer? It's like an envelope that keeps the inside creamy and smooth. You should taste it. It just melts on your palate. It's great. It comes in a package that's traditionally French. And it honors the region that the cheese has come from. It's baby brie from Alouette.
It's good. It goes really well with the wine, I think. Yeah, the tastes together are very nice.
See? Now I've got to see this. No, you eat that. It's very good.
Thanks for joining us today. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. Join us next time on our... I'm not going to tell you where we're going. That's a surprise. See you then. Bye-bye. Bon appétit. Thank you.